I'm Well, good morning. Thank you guys so much for being with us. Happy anniversary to Broken Community. We're just completely humbled and honored that this has been a one-year adventure and just so excited to see what God has for us next. So if you guys would stand and sing with us this morning.
Let faith arise. Let all agree. There's no power like. Ashley asked me if I'd say something before the next song they're going to sing. The song is called Miracle. This is a song very close to my heart. Most of you know my background, but I was born with a bad hand. And I don't know how many people asked me what happened. I probably told you an alligator bit it. An alligator didn't bite it. And I asked my mother, this was probably 2 or 3 years ago, I said, what's the name of what I have on my hand? And I did some research on it. The condition I was born with, and she never knew this until I found it out, was that 80% of babies born with the condition I was born with in my hand don't make it, because they're also born with cancerous tumors that grow so fast that they're gone by the time they're 3 years old. And I'm here. The people that know my background, I had a doctor tell me one time that he never saw anybody so saturated with alcohol and not dead. He said he can't figure it out. But I can figure it out, and I'm here to tell you. I don't know how many people are here because you can't see from here with the lights in your eyes. But every one of you is a miracle. So just listen to the words of this song.
He has walked upon the open water.
God, that's the biggest miracle of all, but we also recognize the miracle in our own lives that without you, that we have nothing, God. So we just pray that you would speak with our hearts today, God. I pray for Michael and the message that you would give him clarity and the words to say that you would have our hearts to hear. God, we're just so thankful for BC and for this incredible church family that you've assembled together, God. And we just pray we can honor you in everything we do today. In your name we pray, amen. You may be seated.
I'm always so proud of them and all they do and what God is doing. Well, happy 1 year anniversary of BC. We've got to give God glory for that. And so we had started last week a brand new series where we're talking about Rewired, and it's all in your head. And so what we've been looking at is we're starting to look through God's word and saying, hey, how do I have victory in my mind? And so one of the most popular passages of this, one of the most popular scriptures of this, Paul is talking to the Romans, and here's what he says in Romans chapter 2, verse 12, verse 2. He says, "Do not conform to the pattern of this world. Don't think like the world thinks. Don't act like the world acts. Don't behave like the world behaves. Do not conform to the pattern of this world." He says, "But be transformed, be changed." How are we changed? How do we not think like the world thinks? How do we not act like the world acts? How do we not behave like the world acts or the world behaves? He says it by renewing your mind. He said it really starts with the way that we think. And so we're going to be talking about over the next couple of weeks, and what we kind of started last week is how do we have victory in our minds? How do we rewire our brains? How do we renew our minds in such a way that we have God-honoring thoughts instead of constantly being bombarded by the lies of the enemy? Now, I don't know about you, but it's really easy for me to make dumb and irrational decisions. Anyone else, wives, don't hate your husbands. Like, it's so easy for me to make a dumb and irrational decision or just do something that just doesn't make sense. And so I'll kind of give you an example. So right before the summer, our summer vacation, we always kind of try to pack food and get things, everything prepped so that when we get down there, we don't have to make as much. And so one of the things that Ashley makes is these pepperoni rolls. They're from God. And what she does is she takes, you know, one of those long pepperonis, and she cuts it up into different pieces and puts a biscuit around it. And it's such a great snack to have at the pool or at the beach or wherever you go. You can just throw them in a bag and you snack on them. It's all week long, you just enjoy them. And so she gives me the opportunity and the responsibility of, I need you to cut the pepperonis this time. So I'm like, okay, you know, it's my job. I'll make sure that they're an even amount. Because here's the thing, there's six of us, four girls. They're all going to fight if one gets a longer pepperoni than the other one. And so I'm thinking, you know what? I've got my new, carpenter mind that I have now is thinking I've got to cut them in equal pieces. So that's what I did. I took out my tape measure, and I measured each pepperoni, and I made sure they were exactly 5 inches each, exactly the same width. Everything had to be perfect. And as he walks in, obviously, she thought that was funny. And so I was like, you know what? I'm trying to save future fights, baby. Right? That was my goal. I'm trying to make everything equal. And so, you know, I just thought it was good to measure it. Well, then we get back, and we have built a pergola on the back porch, and we put some curtains on it, and she gives me straps, and she said, "Babe, can you hang the curtains up?" Now, if you're thinking, you know, he's so meticulous in how he cuts his pepperoni, surely he's going to measure the same distance for each strap on the pergola. Nope, I didn't. I just took the strap, took my hammer and nail, went out there and start putting up all the straps around it. Now here's the thing. We've got straps on all of our curtains, but they're all at different lengths. And so you've got one that's about a quarter of the way up, or a quarter way down from the top. You've got one that's right in the middle. You've got one right down here. And so all four sides are different length, and it just looks really dumb. And so she asked me, she said, "Why is it that when it comes to pepperoni, you get your tape measure out, you measure everything, but something that everybody can see from our backyard, you just put at different lengths. And here was the answer. I don't know. I just make dumb and irrational things sometimes. I don't know why my mind thinks the way that it thinks sometimes. And maybe you're there. You're like, I don't know why I do the same thing over and over again. So maybe you're having a conversation with your wife and you know, today I'm going to be nice. I'm going to try to make up for whatever dumb thing I did yesterday. I'm going to be nice. And then you're trying to be nice and just something sets you off. And instead of being nice, what do we find ourselves? Just arguing with each other. Right? Or maybe for you, it's, you know, I'm gonna really be dedicated. I'm going to try to save money. I'm going to be frugal. And what do? You want to go shopping? Absolutely. Like, it's Amazon Prime Day. Like, it's just you want to trust God. You want to trust God. But what happens? We worry. And so there's things that we want to do. But we want to feel a certain way. We want to think a certain way. But the reality is that we've got our wires completely crossed. And so one of the opportunities that we have is a couple years ago, I was working with Pete's over here. Pete and I used to work together, and we were actually at his daughter's house, and she was having a problem with her microwave. The microwave, it was only working when the light was on. And so we're trying to figure out, you know, what is going on here? And so we're looking at different things, and then we're looking at the light switch, and the, you know, it was off, and so the microwave went off. And we're trying different things. We're like, okay, well, you know, someone really couldn't have wired a microwave to a light switch, could they? So we're still looking around, we're looking at different things, and turn the light back on, and guess what came on? The microwave came on. Do you know how annoying it is when you're in the middle of the night and you want something to be warmed up and you gotta turn a light on to work your microwave? Like, it's not fun. And so what we found out is, as we started taking off all the plates and all the different electrical things, we pulled the light switch out, and they had wired the thing incorrectly. And so instead of it being on the hot terminal, it was on the colder one that just only turned on when the light switch was on. If you unplug it, if you rewire it correctly, then it'll always stay on. See, when we get the wires crossed, it creates some complete issues and problems. And sometimes we look at ourselves and say, well, why did we do something like that? Or, well, how could I have said something like that? Or why did I think something like that? And the complete reason why is because in our brains and in our minds, we have the wires crossed. And so last week we talked about that when we think a thought, there's neural pathways that take place in our brain. In other words, every time that we have a thought, there's a pattern of thought or a pathway that's being made, a mental trail going on in your brain. And the experience and the thought that you have is starting to wire and program the way that you think. And so if you think something long enough and if you believe something, what happens is you start making a default in your brain where if this happens, then my default goes off because I've thought this enough, I've done this enough, I've acted on this enough, where this has become my default. This is the way that my brain is now wired. And so some of us have habits that we're just wired incorrectly. And so this happens at a very young age. So think about it, right? When a baby smiles, what's your immediate reaction? You smile back, right? You can't be unhappy with a smiling baby. So a baby smiles, mom smiles back and gives her that little goo 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 goo, right? Like whatever, you're playing with their feet or you're talking to them, and baby thinks, what happens? When I smile, I get a good response. And so what happened is that baby is now making pathways. She's creating pathways in her mind that are patterns in her thought that when I smile, I get a good response. What happens when a child touches a hot stove? What do they learn? They learn hot is bad, right? In that moment, touching a hot stove, they learn that is bad. And so what ends up happening is the baby learned, the child learned. when I touch this, my body feels pain, my brain reacting in a way that I don't like. And it's creating neural pathways. What happens? The baby's not going to do that again. And if they do, they learn the same lesson again. Right? Or when they're young, when they want a sucker, what do they do? Mommy, can I have a sucker? No, you can't have a sucker. So they've learned something. What did they learn? Everyone knows it. What did they learn? If they cry, what did they get? A sucker! They've learned how to get what they want. And so now when our kids are no longer kids and they're teenagers and young adults and they don't get what they want, what happens? They cry. Why? Because that's what they've learned. That's what they've learned. And you become the sucker. Just kidding. Just kidding. Actually, I'm not kidding. But that's what happens. Why? Why? Because our brain has learned this. This has become our default. If I do something over and over and this is the response that I get, then that's the outcome that I'm going to have. And so we've learned these things in our minds. We're creating new neural pathways. And the more that I travel on them, the more the easier they become to think again. And so the more dominant that thought becomes, the good news is, if it's a God-honoring thought, man, you have defaulted God-honoring thoughts in your mind. But the bad news is if that thought is a lie that you're believing, that Satan has given to you, maybe something about yourself or who you are, and you're starting to believe that lie, that's really bad. Because now you've defaulted in your mind that when I show up or when I'm here or when I arrive or when I'm there or wherever I am, man, my default has a negative habit, a negative thought process going on. And so what happens is our wires get crossed. It's not turning on the way it should turn on. And so kind of last week we said, hey, this is so foundational. And so we'll cover some of the things last week that were foundational, and then we're going to build on them today. And so last week we talked about, why is it so important? Why is it so important to train our minds, to rewire our minds? Because our mind is a battlefield. And most of life's battles are either won or lost in the mind. It's won or lost in the mind. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, Paul tells us, for though we live in the world, it says, do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish stronghold. What's a stronghold? It's a wrong pattern. It's a wrong thinking. It's a prison. We're in a man-made prison trapped by our lies. That's a stronghold. He said we have divine power to demolish strongholds. It's the place where our brains have been wired and crossed. To demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. Why does it matter so much? Why are we spending a month talking about the way that we think? It's because your life is always moving in the direction of your strongest thoughts. Your life is always moving in the direction of your strongest thoughts. And here's the thing. It was estimated that a person has around 6,000 thoughts a day. Can you imagine 6,000 thoughts? Some of you are a lot more. Some of you, a lot less, right? We 6,000 is the average. And here's the thing that I know about myself. When my mind drifts, it doesn't always drift to the things of God. Like when my mind just kind of goes, it drifts so quickly. And the things that it drifts toward aren't usually things that are true. It drifts towards my insecurities. It drifts towards my fears. It drifts towards worst case scenario. It drifts towards the lies that I've been telling myself that I'm not good enough, or I'm incapable, or I should live my life in shame, or God can never use me again. Our mind tends to drift very quickly, and it usually doesn't drift to things that are good. And so what comes into our minds often comes out in our life. What we think determines what we do. And so we can't have a positive life when we have a negative mind, when the wires in our mind are crossed. And so if we don't control what we think, we'll never control what we do. And so today, what I want to do is I really want to give you tools to help you in this journey, to help you in this life of how do I start to rewire my mind? How do I start to train my thoughts? Now, I don't know about you, but I'm guessing a lot of you probably haven't thought about training your minds. Right? Maybe you thought about training your dog. Right? We've got a cute dog, Lily, 12 years old, cute as can be, dumb as I know. I just dumb dog. Right? In 12 years, we've got her to do one trick. Sit. Now, I did get her when she hears, we have the Life 360 app, so we kind of always know what's going on. And so there's a certain sound that's made when it says, you know, Ashley has arrived at home. And the dog hears the sound. And she runs to the door. And here's what I can tell her. I said, Lily, who's here? Lily, who's here? Now, here's the problem now. Over the last couple months, she started to have congestive heart failure. So not only is she dumb, she's also dying. So I'm sorry. She's cute as can be, just not that smart. I'm sorry. She'll never know that I said this about her. But now I can't do that with her. Because if I say, hey, Lily, who's here? And so we thought, I'm sorry, I don't know where I went with that. Nothing. Training your dog, you thought about training your dog. You thought about training your body, right? There's ideas that we think about. We train our bodies, right? And when you think about training your body, what do you think about? You think about exercise, right? I'm gonna run. I'm gonna jump. I'm gonna do sit-ups. I'm gonna do kettlebells. I'm gonna do everything that I can to work out my body. But here's what you realize when you're training your body: it's not just what you do with your body; it's what you put into your body that also matters. And I think that that's so true with the way that we think. Right? It's not just what's going on. It's not just the circumstances around us. It's what we're constantly feeding ourselves as well. That matters, and that changes how we think, and what we think is true and what we think is a lie. And so what we're going to learn from Paul, he is writing to a letter to the church at Philippi. And he's coming to the end of his letter. And after he writes everything that he wants to write to them, he says, okay, I've got one more thing I want you to think about. He closes his letter with this. Now, here's the thing. When you think about a letter that you're writing, one of the last things that you do is think about, hey, how am I going to end this? Because sometimes that's the most important thing that person can give you. And so he's writing this letter. He's in, he's more than likely locked up in house arrest. He's not in an ideal situation. It would be a terrifying place. He's awaiting to hear of his possible execution. This is kind of a worst case scenario. This is where he is when he's writing this letter to this church, to this body of believers, trying to encourage them. Here's what he says, chapter 4, verse 8. He says, and now, dear brothers and sisters, he says, one final thing. This is the last thing I'm going to leave with you. And here's what he didn't say. He didn't say, you know what, God let me down. He didn't say that. He didn't say, you know, I can't keep going on with life. He didn't say that. He didn't say, hey, things couldn't get any worse. He didn't say that. Here's his last thoughts to encourage this church. He says, one final thing. Fix your thoughts. Fix your thoughts. In other words, Paul never let his circumstances dictate his thoughts. Here's what he said. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. I mean, think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. I mean, think about that. He said, the one last thing he says, and I want you to, if you get nothing else from this letter, here's what I want you to do. One last thing is I want you to start fixing your thoughts on what is true, what is honorable, what is right, what is pure, what is lovely, what is admirable, what is excellent, what is worthy of praise. What he didn't say is, hey, I don't want you to fix your thoughts on the worst case scenario. Right? Because that's often my default. Right, when I'm in a situation or that, don't fix your thoughts on what you hate, on what you're afraid of, on what could go wrong. But fix your thoughts on what is good. Fix your thoughts on what is good. Three tools from this passage that I want to leave with you. The first one is this. If we're going to rewire our minds, we've got to start filtering our thoughts. Filtering our thoughts. Now, Paul gives us a grid or a filter, which is kind of used as a tool. And when we're trying to understand, trying to see, hey, where do our thoughts come from? And is this a true thought or is this a lie? Or is this right or is this wrong? Paul gives us a sifter to sift our thoughts through. And so when a thought comes into our mind, here's what our instinct should be. Is this right? Is this true? Is this honorable? Is this pure? Is this lovely? Is this of excellence? Is there any worthiness of praise in this? And so he gives us this tool that he gives us to sift our thoughts. Because what happens is when we're going through life, we have 6,000 thoughts a day. So you've got all of these thoughts going into your mind and into your life. And you're wondering, hey, where is this thought? And what is this thought? And is this thought right? And is this thought good? And what Paul says is, hey, as you go through your life and as you're thinking through it, what I want you to do is I want you to sift through and use this as a guide and sift through and say, you know what, I'm going to allow the good thoughts, I'm going to let the God-honoring thoughts, I'm going to let those go through, but the thoughts that aren't good, the thoughts that aren't God-honoring, the thoughts that are lies of the enemy that he's been telling us for years, you know what I'm going to do with those thoughts? I'm going to capture them. And I'm not going to let them go through. And I'm going to filter them through and say, you know what? Because of what God's word says, I'm going to have a filter on my thoughts. That say, I'm only going to allow those thoughts that are God-honoring. And what am I going to do with these thoughts? Well, remember the passage last week. I'm going to take every thought captive and make it obedient to Christ. So I'm not going to add these thoughts into my mind. I'm not going to allow these thoughts to penetrate my mind. Why? Because I've got a filter put up. And what do I use to filter? God's word. Is it true? Is it honorable? Is it right? Is it pure? Is it lovely? Is it admirable? Is there any excellence in it? Is there praise in this? If the answer is yes, go on through. Right? Go on. Allow it to penetrate your mind. But if the answer is no to any of those, then put the filter in place. Put up the block. This is, you know what? I'm going to take that thought captive. I'm not going to let it go to my mind. I'm not going to let it go to my heart. Because our lives are always dictated by our strongest thoughts. So I'm going to stop allowing those thoughts to be a part of my life, and I'm going to filter them out. If we're ever going to rewire our minds, then we've got to filter our thoughts. Here's the second thing that Paul gives us. Master meditation. Master meditation. Look at the passage. It says, now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. And then he says this, think on these things. Guess what that word means? Meditate. The New King James Version translates it like this. If there's any virtue or if anything praiseworthy, what's he say? Meditate. Meditate on these things. And I know when we say meditate, there's an image that comes into our mind. Isn't this a new age, spooky, like one with the universe? Fingers awkwardly placed, and hands and arms crossed, and we're making chants. That's not the meditation that we're talking about. There is a scriptural, healthy meditation. And here's the definition of it. It's to engage in mental exercise or to focus one's thoughts. It is to engage in mental exercise, to focus one's thoughts. It's to focus. Right? When you look at Scripture, there's time and time again in different believers and different authors of the Scripture. They talk about this idea of meditation and the power of thinking and focusing on God's words. The psalmist in Psalm 119:15 says this, is, I meditate, God. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. What is he saying? Hey, I'm focusing my mind. I'm thinking about, I'm dwelling upon, I'm meditating on, God, your word and your truth. I'm training my mind. Psalm 143:5 says it like this. I remember the days long ago. I meditate on all your works and consider what your hands have done. What is the psalmist saying there? Hey, now I'm going to meditate on, God, what you have done in my life. I'm going to think about that. I'm going to think about what you've done. And instead of just thinking about all the things I lack, God, I'm going to think about all the things that your hands have done and all the works that you have done in our life. And so oftentimes when we think about meditation, Eastern meditation is an emptying of your mind where you're trying to focus on nothing, where it's a state of calm. But Christian meditation, biblical meditation, isn't emptying your mind, but it's actually filling your mind with truth. But what you're doing is you're filling your mind with truth. You're not emptying yourself and you're not emptying your mind. No, you're filling your mind with God's truth. You're training your thoughts. And here's what I found out just in our own personal studies, my own personal spiritual development. Man, it is hard for me to focus. It's hard to focus. Because focus takes a skill. The great theologian, Jackie Chan, in the new movie, The Karate Kid, which is not as good as the original Karate Kid, nor is it as good as Cobra Kai. But here's what he says. He says, your focus needs more focus. Your focus needs more focus. And isn't that true of us? Where your focus needs more focus. Where if our minds are going to uncross the wires that are already programmed, that are not true, then what we need is more focus on what is true. What we need to do is meditate and learn to master meditation, where we're not emptying our minds, but we're filling our minds. We're focusing our minds. We're training our minds on God's word. And so last week, I gave you an assignment. There were two questions that I wanted you to really wrestle with this week. The first one was, what stronghold is holding you back? What would you say is the top wrong mindset that's holding you hostage, where you say, hey, this is where my wires are crossed? For some of you, it could be a lie. Right? Or patterns that you've seen in your life or in your family. Where you look in the group in the household that you grew up in, struggle with finances, and so what do we think? I'm never going to be good at this, or I'm never going to get out of debt. And so we struggle with mindset. Our wires are crossed. Or maybe for you, it's I can't overcome this addiction. My parents had this addiction. My grandparents had this addiction. I've got this addiction, and I'm never going to get past this addiction. Or maybe it's the, I'm never going to be healthy. My family's not healthy. Nobody in my house is healthy. I'm never going to be healthy. Or I've tried to be close to God. Man, I tried to pray one time, and I was really into it for those first 5 minutes, but my mind just, I don't think I can ever be close to God. Or maybe it's, I'm never going to get married. Or I'm never going to have a happy or blessed marriage. Whatever it is, what is the dominant stronghold where your mental wires are crossed, where the devil has trained you, where you put down mental pathways that you believe something that is not true at you? What is that? What is the stronghold? And the second assignment that I gave you, the second part of that, was what is the spiritual truth from God's word that demolishes the stronghold? Like, what is it that's the truth about that? What's the passage of Scripture? Because here's the thing. It's not just one thing to know truth about it. You've got to know what God's word says about it. And so out of that, we meditate on it. And we start changing the way that we think. And so here's how we're going to say it this week. We're going to write it, think it, confess it, until we believe it. What are we gonna do? We're gonna take the tools. We're gonna write it. We're gonna think it. We're gonna confess it until we believe it. But we're gonna write it. We're gonna think it. We're gonna confess it until we believe it. Why are we gonna do that? Because we need to rewire our mind. But we need to change the pathways that our thoughts have been going down, and we're changing it from ones that were not honoring God to ones that are honoring God, and it's renewing our mind with God's word. And so it's going to take some time. And so what do? We're going to write it. We're going to think it. We're going to confess it until you believe it. So here's some, let me give you some examples of what that might look like. Maybe you're struggling to know God's will in your life. And so for you, you're going to write something like this. Man, my life belongs to God. Daily I seek him, and daily he directs my steps. I know his voice, and he leads me to his perfect will. God, I don't know what's going on. And so God, here's my thing. I'm struggling, God. And so God, my life belongs to you. Daily I'm going to seek you. Daily I'm going to have you direct my steps. I know his voice, and he leads me into his perfect will. What am I going to do? I'm going to write it. I'm going to think it. I'm going to confess it until I believe it. How about this? Maybe you lack confidence. Every time you're here, you're insecure, you're inadequate, you don't feel like you're enough. For you, maybe your sentence goes like this. My confidence is in Christ and in Christ alone. Because his spirit lives within me, I can do everything he calls me to do. I'm going to write it. I'm going to think it. I'm going to confess it until I believe it. I'm struggling with fighting lustful thoughts. Maybe you're sick and tired of being hostage to the images and the shame. And here's what God is going to use to renew our minds. And I'm not a slave to lustful thoughts, because God has purified my mind, and I will honor him with my thoughts and my eyes, with my eyes and my thoughts. My God is faithful, and even if I am tempted, he will always give me a way out. What are we going to do? We're going to write it. We're going to think it. We're going to confess it until we believe it. We're meditating on what God's word says. You might find comfort in food, but where you don't want to do that anymore. And so when I'm stressed, I turn to God, not food. I come to Jesus because he is what I need. In him, I find strength and comfort. Maybe you're battling worry all the time. You're consumed by worry. Your sentence is, because of Christ, I'm not anxious about anything. I cast my cares on God because he cares for me. I have the peace of God dwelling in my heart and ruling in my mind. What are we going to do? We're going to write it. We're going to think it. We're going to confess it until we believe it. It's going to take time. You're rewiring the way that your mind thinks. You're going down a new path. And you're trying to cover up with time and truth the old path. We're going to master meditation. What is the stronghold on where your wires are crossed? And what is the spiritual truth that sets
you free. We're going to write it. We're going to think it. We're going to confess it until we believe it. This is something that Ashley and I have had to overcome in our hearts and in our minds. Our minds drive us crazy sometimes. And so one of the exercises that we have put in our lives, and one of the things that we did last year, is that we came up with 12 different declarations that this is who we are. And this is what God has called us to. And so for us, each declaration is something about our life, but we always have a verse tied to what it is. And so I'm going to share ours with you. And here's what I encourage you to do. Man, either by yourself or with your spouse, come up with your declarations. I'm going to give you a copy of ours so that you have them, so that you can, that they maybe can help jumpstart something in your life. But what is it for you? What is the things that you need to meditate on? Here's ours. Number one, Jesus is first in our life. That we exist to serve and glorify Him. That we love our spouse and will lay down our life to serve them. Our children will love God and serve Him with their whole hearts. And we will nurture, equip, train, and empower them to do more for His kingdom than they can ever imagine. We are growing closer to Jesus every day. Because of Christ, my family is closer, my body is stronger, my faith is deeper, and my leadership is sharper. Our words, thoughts, and imaginations are under the power of Christ. And I take all thoughts captive and make them obedient to Christ. We wake up with purpose, direction, and meaning every day for our life. We are not our past. We are not what we did. We are who God says we are. And He says that we are forgiven. He says that we are redeemed. He says that we are free. We will be dedicated to love like Christ and to make followers of Him. Our God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, of love, and of a sound mind. We are empowered. We are chosen. We are called. We are a masterpiece of God, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for me to do. Our confidence is in Christ and in Christ alone. Because His Spirit lives within me, I can do everything He calls me to do, and the world will be different and better because we serve Jesus today.
Amen.
What are your declarations? Like, what is it that in your mind, this is why my life matters. This is why taking my mind and rewiring it is so important. Because our life is always moving in the direction of our strongest thoughts. Here's the last part. Tools to rewire our minds. Filter your thoughts. Master meditation. Come up with your set of declarations. What are the things that you're going to say that God has said to you about you? Then here's the last one, power in praise. And there is so much power in praise. Remember what he says, Philippians 4:8, now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and what? Worthy of praise. One of the quickest ways for me to get discouraged is to look at, to think about, to talk about all the negativity that's going on around us, all the negativity in our world, in our country, and to focus on all the negativity. And when we focus on the negativity, what do we miss? And we miss seeing God working all around us and in us. We miss and we forget to praise God. God, thank you for the breath that I have. Thank you for the life that you've given me. God, I have so much to praise you for. And the psalmist in 103 says it like this. He says, praise the Lord, my soul. All my innermost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul. And let's just say, forget not all his benefits. And what are some of those benefits? Man, he forgives us. He forgives all of our sins. And he heals all your diseases. He redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the opposed. Man, do our minds think about all that God has done in our life and praise Him? See, there is power in praise. And there's power in hearing stories of what God is doing in other people's life. And then some of the best reminders that God is still at work is to hear what God is doing in someone's life. And so I've asked a couple people, just share briefly, give us a short synopsis. What is some things that you are praising God for? And so I'll ask Lynn to come up, and then after Lynn, Randy will come and share, and then we'll close out our time together. Do you have your microphone?
Good morning. One of the things that I worry about is this microphone. I didn't do too well with it last time I was using it, but we're going to try it today, and hopefully it gets me through without going in and out. So how has God been working in my life? Well, I can tell you for a fact that if He wasn't, I wouldn't be standing up here today. And He knows how fast my little heart is beating right now. He knows that I'm nervous. And He knows how I'm waiting for this mic to just start going in and out, because we didn't get along last time. So when I was thinking about what I was going to say today, I started having a conversation with God yesterday. And I said, you know what? I need help with this. I don't know what to say. I've never done this. I'm not comfortable with this. So I started writing. And I wrote all this stuff on my phone. And so I was thinking and writing all day yesterday, up to 10 o'clock last night. Even woke up at 2:30 this morning and thought, no, I got to change that. And then I woke up this morning, and guess what God said? Wing it. I'm like, really? So I'm winging it a little bit. I'm reading a little bit, so please forgive me as I do all of this and shake and try to get my bearings together. So last summer, I was invited to a Bible study. Never been to a Bible study, and I was nervous, shy, didn't talk much, didn't want to share much. Small talk was okay. Getting to know folks were okay, but that was it for me. I was always very scared of sharing my thoughts and just getting it wrong. So, in a way, I just didn't feel like I was qualified to talk about Jesus, church, and the Bible, and didn't dare want anybody to ask me to pray when it was all over and said no. Don't even ask me to pray. Never prayed in front of people before. But little did I know that this thing called Broken Community Church was going to happen. And then all this started a year ago, and we had our first service. And little did I know, God had bigger plans than I did for myself and got me out of my comfort zone. He knew I was qualified in my own way. He got me excited about my church, leaning on Him more and less on myself, more praying with purpose all the time, not just when something wasn't going right, and talking about Him and sharing my heart without fear. I'm now not going to a church. I'm part of a church. I serve and co-captain of the frontline team here. I pray out loud in our team huddles sometimes now. I'm going to co-lead a community group next month. I would have never imagined any of this, but God did. I'm not the same person I was a year ago. I have a personal relationship with God, pursuing His purpose for me and following His lead. I'm so thankful for all God has done in my life to draw me closer to Him and to trust Him to step out and do the uncomfortable. So thankful for Michael and Ashley, the Broken Community, and all of my church family, because if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't be here today.
Thank you.
10 years ago, almost 10 years ago, I met Mike in Nashville. And I wasn't the person I am today. I didn't have the beautiful wife I had. Now I do. 18 years ago, I had a cocaine habit. God uses people in our lives different ways. You never know. It may be your daughter. It was mine. She was 4 years old. God used her to get me off of that drug. I don't want it anymore. Don't want to be around it. I have changed some of my thought process. But since I married Vicki, my thought process has changed greatly. I am not the person I was yesterday. I'm not going to be the person tomorrow I am today, hopefully. God has blessed me beyond what I deserve, what any of us deserve. We were all told this morning that we are all miracles, and we are, each and every one of us. We should be thankful for every day. I am so proud to be part of this church. I'm proud of Mike and Ashley. I'm proud of each and every person here. Lynn, I am so proud of you today. I am so proud. We went to school together, her and my wife, and her husband, Trey. We all know each other. But God has a plan for each of us. And I used to fight it tooth and nail. I didn't want to do it. Don't want to do it. That's not what I want to do. I finally gave up. Said, all right, God, you want me to be a truck driver like my dad? That's fine. I'll do it. Now I love going to Brooklyn, New York, the Bronx, Queens, any borough, any type of place I can get in. My wife gets nervous. I don't. Don't understand it, but whatever. But he's gave me abilities that a lot of people don't want to have, I guess you could say. They've got them, they just don't want to use them. And I give God praise every morning for my life, for my wife, for him forgiving me most of all. Because I am not worthy of his forgiveness. But because he is God, he says, I'm here.
That's hard to follow up with, and just thank you guys so much for sharing your hearts. You know, I think there's so many other stories within this building that people can share, and hopefully, you know, one day they'll all be willing and want to do that as well. But you know, we've seen so much growth. We've seen stories and heard stories of how people. We're all broken. We are all so broken, and you know, God can redeem your story. It doesn't matter where you've been or what you've done. So I know that this has meant so much to Michael and I, because we were in a very, very dark place for quite some time. And I know we didn't really talk about this side of it, but, you know, BC, it was nerve-wracking to do this. It was nerve-wracking to step back out and to say, okay, God, if this is what you want for us, we're gonna step out in faith, but we're scared to death. But the purpose, you know, I think was more for us to heal and to get to a place where we could have that relationship with Jesus and with our church family, because we need each other. Trying to do this alone is not an easy task. So we're just so thankful for each of you and love you guys so much. But back to the story I'm supposed to be telling. You guys know that we've been looking for a bigger space, and we're so thankful for the space that God has given us. This building has been such an incredible blessing. The owners have been more generous than we could have ever even imagined. So, but we do need more space. You guys can hear the kids. You know, we're right on top of each other, and we're so thankful and blessed to have this building. But it is a challenge, and we know that our mission is to reach people who are lost and don't know Jesus. And with this space, that's limited. So, a few weeks ago, a month ago, 2 months ago, we had found a building that we had tried to purchase or tried to rent. It was going to be a full-time facility, and we all went as a church and looked at it, so excited. And on Monday, I reached back out to the rental agent, and it had already gotten rented from the owners, so they didn't know that we were interested in it, and we were all heartbroken. So a few weeks ago, I was riding around. I had to go to the shop to write a check, and I was on my way back and thought, well, I'll ride by that building to see what's going on. So I rode by and saw some people inside. They had some tools, and I could tell they were getting ready for something. And as I left, I just felt a little deflated and defeated, but I thought, I'm going to, you know, end this situation. And I challenged myself to pray for whatever is going into that building, that God will bless it if it's another church or whatever is going in there. But I was praying about, you know, God, we really want to honor you, and we want to do your will, and we want to be where you want us. So I'm driving around, and there was another building that we had kept our eyes on for a while that had gone out of business from its previous owners, and we just had our eye on it. Well, I saw some people in there working, so out of my comfort zone again, I thought, I'm going to stop by and talk to these people. So I went in and was greeted by a lovely lady who... obviously, I was very unexpected that day, so I just shared with her, you know, our church is looking for a bigger facility. We're looking for a space that we can spread out. And it just really caught her off guard because it's an event center. She's thinking wedding, corporate events, all these other things. And she said, you know, she gave me a tour, and we had a conversation, and she said that she'd be praying about it. So that Saturday, Michael and I went and looked during the open house, and they ended up giving us an offer on that Monday, so just a few days later. But So anyways, you know, this space is roughly between 1,500 and 2,000 square feet. The building that we're going to be getting is over six times the size of this space. We're going to have room for our kids. We're going to have separate rooms across the entire building. We'll have a cafe. But as of September 25th, this will be our last Sunday here, and we're going to be able to move into the new building on October the 2nd. So we just want to thank God for that. Looking back at the situation of us getting the building that would have been full-time as opposed to this, we'll still be a portable location. But the finance aspect of it and what it will allow us to do, God had the plan. He had us all along. You know, even though we were deflated, we were disappointed, we thought that we knew what was best, but this situation is going to allow us to do so much more. So we're just, God is still working. I'm trying to wrap it up, but another side note that is such a beautiful thing, we reached out to another friend, and there is a church in Winston-Salem that was a portable church for 10 years, and they have gone to a permanent facility, and we went to visit them this past week, and there's going to be some additional materials and supplies that we need for this bigger space, but they have a movie theater, and one of the movie theaters was completely full of carts, projectors, screens, I mean, play panels, everything that you could imagine that we would need, and actually more than was even on our wish list, that they want to bless our church with it and just give it to us for free. So all these things are just God. So I just wanted to give him the glory and just, you know, praise him for what he has done and what he's continuing to do. So let's give him a hand this morning.
You know, three tools that Paul gives us from this passage of rewiring our thoughts and rewiring our minds. Filter your thoughts, master meditation, and power and praise. And here's the thing, what I love about this, we can go seat by seat. We won't, but we could go seat by seat and just hear praises of what God has done. And so will you pray with me? Father, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for your goodness and your kindness, your grace and your mercy. But God, most of all, we thank you for Jesus. God, I pray as we go through this series and we're thinking about, God, how do you wire our minds and the way that we think? So many of us can feel so defeated every day. The moment we wake up, we've got lies bombarding us from Satan, lies of our past, lies of our future, that have taken us captive. God, I pray that through Jesus, we can have a victory in our lives. God, I pray for anyone who's never put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of their sin and give them eternal life. God, in just a moment, I'm going to pray, and there's nothing magical about the prayers, but it is simply opening up our hearts to God and saying, God, I want to put you first. And I want to trust you with all that I have. And if that's you today, say, God, I want you first in my life. I've never put my trust in you for the forgiveness of your sin and give me eternal life. And would you make that decision today and pray something like this? Dear Jesus, I admit that I'm a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe that you died for me on the cross, that you were buried, and that you rose from the grave. Today I turn from my sin, and I invite you into my life and into my heart. Today I trust you and follow you as Lord and Savior. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Would you give God what you want this morning? If you said, Mike, today I put my faith and trust in Jesus Christ, then we would love to hear about your decision. Around you is a connection card. Just fill that information out. Hand it to Ashley and I or any of our VIP team that's going to be up front here. And they'll get you connected. They'll get you some resources to help you grow in your relationship with God. In just a moment, we're going to pray. We're going to sing. But while we're singing, we're also going to take up our offering. Our offering is for those who call BC home. So if you're a guest with us, if you're still trying to figure out Christianity and this whole church thing and how does it work, we don't want you to feel any obligation or any responsibility to give. This is a what we call a family thing. And so would you guys just stand and sing with us?
Deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the
our day. Just thank you guys so much for being here and celebrating our 1 year anniversary. It's such a special day for us. So we have made cupcakes. Michael actually assisted in this, so they will be on the bar as you exit. So make sure you grab one or two or however many you want and just enjoy. Let's see, if you're a first-time guest with us today, there should be a connection card on one of the chairs around you. If you would fill that out and then bring it to Michael and I as you exit, we would love to meet you and give you a gift. Also, the handouts from our declarations that Michael read earlier, just to kind of give you guys a guide, something to go on, we really want to encourage you guys to do this. It's so helpful and can get you jump-started, so grab one of those on your way out of the door. Also, we have bundles of invite cards. You guys are going to have your hands full when you leave today. But for our new facility, the address will be on the back, and when we start, will be on the back. And then they're in bundles of seven. So we just want to challenge you guys, if there are people in your life, in your community, at your work, in your family that you feel like would love to come and visit and just see what we're doing here at BC, we would love to have them, especially when we get into our new facility. And then as a body, we're actually going to go look at the new building on next Sunday. It'll be the 18th at 2 o'clock. That's the earliest that we could get there, so you can come to church, go to lunch, and then we'll all meet over there so we can go in and take a look and kind of give you guys the vision for what it's going to be and what it's going to look like. So thank you guys again. Happy anniversary. We love you so much and hope you have a great week.
Yeah, yeah.